on a crisp afternoon as the sun dipped low, casting long shadows over the countryside. Erna Petri, a German housewife, was going home from a routine shopping trip. The tranquility of the scene was abruptly shattered when her gaze fell upon a chilling sight. Six small boys, their bodies frail and shivering, huddled together by the side of the road, their eyes wide with terror. Erna, at 23, was no stranger to the harsh realities of her time, married as she was to a senior SS officer. Her heart recognized the frightened children immediately. They were the very ones whispered about in hushed, fearful tones. Jews who had miraculously escaped from a train destined for an extermination camp. With a mother's instinct, Erna's initial reaction was compassion. She could not ignore the pangs of empathy for these starving souls, reminiscent of her children back home. So, she extended a hand of false kindness, offering shelter and a comforting meal to the terrified children. However, a sinister shadow fell over the scene as the day waned. The same hand that had fed these six innocent lives, the youngest, a mere 6 years old, the oldest barely 12, would soon lead them into the forest depths. There, on the edge of a dark pit, a chilling act unfolded as Erna methodically silenced each young life. Her pistol, a stark contrast to the nurturing facade she had shown hours earlier. This harrowing tale, a glimpse into the duality of human nature, forms the heart of a startling revelation. A new book, born from extensive research and the uncovering of long-buried archives, casts a chilling light on the Third Reich, revealing a facet more sinister than previously imagined. Erna Petri was not an anomaly. Hitler's Furies, a compelling narrative by Holocaust historian Professor Wendy Lower, unveils the unsettling truth about the role of women in the Nazi regime. Tens of thousands of German women, far beyond what history books have recorded, were active participants in the horrific acts of the era, challenging the long-held belief that such atrocities were solely the deeds of men. The narrative weaves through the dark corridors of the Holocaust, traditionally viewed as a male-perpetrated crime, with women relegated to the roles of bystanders or victims. Yet, as Loa's research reveals, this perspective is dangerously simplistic. German women, driven by the same twisted ideology that ensnared their male counterparts, were far from innocent. Their hands, too, were stained with the blood of the innocent. From the professional caretakers who, under the guise of purity and health, carried out unspeakable acts to the notorious female guards whose cruelty knew no bounds, the story unfolds, revealing a chilling truth. Women, woven into the very fabric of Nazi Germany, were not simply bystanders, but played active, pivotal roles in the most sinister episodes of its history. As the narrative delves deeper into this uncharted history, a question lingers, haunting and profound. How did so many, once tasked with nurturing and caring, find themselves entwined in a web of such unimaginable evil? The answer awaits, hidden in the shadows of a past that is both horrifyingly real and eerily relevant today. In the midst of a society twisted by ideology, German midwives, once symbols of life and hope, found themselves entangled in a grim narrative. Their hands, meant to welcome new life into the world, became instruments of betrayal. They marked the innocent unborn and newborn alike for termination, swayed by a perverse doctrine that valued purity over the sanctity of life. These women, custodians of birth, were now architects of death, recommending abortions, euthanasia, and the sterilization of mothers deemed unfit by a corrupted regime. Historian Professor Wendy Lower casts a stark light on this chilling transformation, unveiling how these women, trapped in a web of moral decay, became callous arbiters of life and death. A boundary of humanity had been breached. The plunge into the abyss was rapid as the pursuit of racial purity transformed into the final solution. This policy cloaked the systematic genocide of millions of Jews under the guise of official decree. The collaboration was widespread. Millions of German women, imbued with the notion of the Jew as the enemy, became silent witnesses, if not active participants, in this horror. They were labeled primary witnesses of the Holocaust, a chilling reminder of the pervasive nature of this atrocity. Their denial of knowledge is a feeble defense against the undeniable truth of their involvement. The epicenter of these horrors was the Wild East territories in Poland, Ukraine, and parts of Russia, freshly seized by Hitler through brute force. Here, the genocide took on a brutal, unmasked form. Over 500,000 women ventured into these conquered lands, becoming the unsuspecting accomplices in an extermination of unprecedented scale. The banality of evil was striking. Secretaries, the cogs in the vast Nazi machinery, typed orders for mass murder and meticulously filed the details of slaughters, their mundane routines a stark contrast to the monstrous reality they facilitated. Yet, blinded by ambition or numbed by denial, they remained ignorant, basking in the shadow of power rather than confronting the dreadful truth. But the signs were omnipresent. How could they ignore the haunting presence of mass graves, the stench of death permeating their idyllic picnics in the countryside? The piles of clothes, the personal belongings, once treasured by their rightful owners, now catalogued for redistribution, did they not question the origins of these spoils of genocide? Professor Lower denounces this era as the biggest campaign of organized robbery in history, with German women positioned as both key operatives and beneficiaries of this haul. Yet, specific figures stood out amidst this grim tableau in their iniquity. Take Liselotte Meyer, an administrator whose identity seemed to merge with that of her SS officer boss. Together, they embodied the very essence of the regime's brutality, partaking in shooting parties as a grotesque form of sport, hunting and executing Jews amidst the snow-covered landscape. As this dark chapter unfolds, one is left to ponder how did ordinary women, once the nurturers and keepers of life, descend into such depths of cruelty and indifference? The answer lies buried in the annals of history, a haunting reminder of the fragility of morality under the shadow of tyranny. In the early, grim days of the Holocaust, death came most often by the bullet. In the bleak landscapes of Belarus, one woman found herself at the nexus of life and death, her decisions sealing the fates of many. As she orchestrated the logistics with the execution squads, her power was absolute, choosing who would survive and who would not. The absurdity of survival, hung by the thinnest of threads a Jewish hairdresser lived because she was deemed essential to vanity. At the same time, another's life was extended merely to finish a piece of knitting. Such were the whims that dictated life and death in those dark times. Yet, the secretaries, the seemingly innocuous cogs in the Nazi machine, played a role more sinister than mere administrative aides. Post-massacre, as the air hung heavy with the aftermath of horror, these women provided refuge for the SS executioners. Some sought solace in their arms, seeking to drown the guilt in schnapps or momentary comfort. In contrast, others, lost in a haze of brutality, sought a brief respite at refreshment tables set up by these same women amidst the backdrop of execution. But the darkness of the human soul revealed itself most chillingly in those who embraced the role of the executioner women, like Erna Petri, whose hands were as stained as the most ruthless SS officer. In the shadow of her husband, she reigned over a grotesque domain in Poland, a mansion built on the suffering of those deemed subhuman, her days marked by the chilling sound of rifle shots aimed at prisoners from her balcony, leisurely. Not far away, Vera Wolof, the embodiment of contradiction, witnessed and abetted the atrocity with chilling detachment. As her husband led the charge to doom for thousands, she stood whip in hand, indifferent to the agony unfolding before her, her unborn child a silent witness to the unfolding cruelty. And in Ukraine, a young secretary, Johanna Altvater, wielded power with a chilling fervor. Known as Fräulein Hannah, her presence was a harbinger of doom. Clad in riding breeches, she herded men, women, and children to their end with a chilling efficiency, her actions an unsettling testament to the depth of inhumanity that had seeped into the very fabric of society. As these tales of darkness and depravity unfold, one is left to ponder the depths to which humanity can sink and the haunting realization that the face of evil is not always as easily discernible as one might wish. In a scene marred by the darkest hues of humanity, Altvetter traversed the sterile hallways of a makeshift hospital, her steps deliberate, her gaze cold and unflinching. She paused in the children's ward, where innocents lay bedridden, her actions devoid of mercy. One by one, she lifted the fragile lives and, without a shred of remorse, hurled them from the balcony, their descent a chilling testament to her depravity. Some fell to their untimely deaths, while others, though they survived, bore the scars of her cruelty. This woman's trademark was a sinister one, her nasty habit, a grim ritual of luring children with the promise of sweets, only to betray their trust with a bullet from her ever-present pistol. Her cruelty knew no bounds, exemplified in the horrific instance where she seized a toddler, his innocence no shield against her barbarity, and ended his life with a brutality that defied comprehension. Even as the father bore witness to this unspeakable act, his words echoed the shock and horror that such savagery could emanate from a woman. Meanwhile, not far from the massacre, a grotesque celebration unfolded. Amid the backdrop of bloodshed, revelers, including this woman, indulged in feasts and merriment, the music's rhythm punctuated by the sporadic sound of gunfire as partygoers casually took breaks from the festivities to contribute to the carnage. Yet, she was not alone in her capacity for violence. Another, a Gestapo wife and mother, wielded her riding crop with a chilling fervor, her attack on a pleading child a stark display of her inhumanity. This woman's cruelty extended beyond physical violence. Her very presence on the streets was a threat, her pram an unlikely weapon in her arsenal of terror. In the aftermath of the war, the narrative of these women, their hands stained with the blood of the innocent, diverged. While a few, like Erna Petri, faced the consequences of their actions, many evaded justice, their pleas of ignorance, a flimsy defense for the indefensible. The chilling reality, as historian Professor Wendy Lower revealed, is that this capacity for violence was not an aberration, but a widespread phenomenon. Millions of women active in the Nazi regime were not mere bystanders, but participants in the horror. To deny their involvement, to cast them as incapable of such atrocities, is to ignore a fundamental truth about human nature. The grim lesson of history is that the capacity for such horror is not confined to the past. It echoes in the present, in the atrocities still unfolding in far-off lands. A stark reminder that the darkness that once plagued the world has not been banished, but lurks, ever present, waiting for the moment to surface again.